That we are discussing a beautiful book, and the cherry on the cake is that we do have the author of the book also live with us. I'm not talking about none other than Miss Kavita Kane, and the book that we are going to discuss is written by her, which is Ahalya's Awakening. To discuss that book, we not only have the author, but we also have our community readers as well. We have Ruchira, we have Lekha, we have Gunjan, and we also have Neha, who's also going to be hosting the session. Before I give it over to Neha to start the session and ask a few questions about the book to the author, I'd like to invite Kavita to say a few things about her journey as an author, as well as about the specific book we are talking about. So over to you, Kavita.
Happy New Year, everyone. And yes, definitely, I think everyone is saying the Happy New Year in a most earnest way. So hoping this year will be happy. So let's keep up the optimistic note. And how long do you want me to talk on myself? Because I can go on, of course. So you
As
want me
long as you
to?
want.
Okay, I'll make it. Nothing, I think. About myself, yes, I was a former journalist, and like every journalist, I wish to write a book. And eventually, when I did, I decided on a non-fiction, because I did not want to write a non-fiction, because I think I'd been doing that in the 20 years of my journalistic career. So it was fiction. I think the genre was mythology. That time, I think mythology wasn't really hadn't take. Really not as popular as it is now. So, but I think yes, I did come at the right time. The book did come at the right time. But I think I took up mythology only because I was more familiar with it because as a literature student, and I knew how mythology is often used as a narrative technique while storytelling. You know, that's the most important. I mean, the most important thing about mythology is the storytelling factor, and I think that's what. And I thought I would write only one book. But I think the surprise success of Karna's Wife gave me the courage, and I think gave the publisher the courage to for the second book. And I think that's how the second book came about, the third, and I think eventually there were six books. And the sixth book is, of course, now the latest is, which is almost a year or so old, is Ahalya's Awakening, which I think the journey from my first book to the sixth book itself, I think as an author, I think the readers would be the best people to know that, because those who have read all the six books will realize that how I think I started moving from not just positive feel-good characters to definitely from the white to the shades of gray, you know, darker shades of gray. I think it actually started with Karna's Wife and of course Urmila and Sita's sister, of course, are extremely sparkling white characters. I think that the dark started creeping in a little in Menka's Choice, which was about Menka, the Apsara. And the next book was on Surpanakha, which who is a famous or rather infamous antagonist of the Ramayana. And I wanted to tell her story. And from Surpanakha, then again Satyavati. Satyavati had again very, very strong in the Fisher Queen dynasty. She again, in her search for power and position, she has very strong shades of the dark and the gray, almost, you know, almost black. So, which, you know, so it's very easy to sort of say she's a white character and she's a black character. And then came a complex character like Ahalya, which we often don't see her. Sadly, we don't see Ahalya as a very complex character at all. We just see her as either a victim or, you know, this whole thing of a devoted wife, and then she's suddenly becoming an adulteress. So this whole arc is itself very fascinating, you know. And I wanted Ahalya, who is again a very sort of a voiceless character. You see the people around her, everyone has their opinions of her. We have an opinion of her, but she doesn't really talk. I mean, so it was, I think this book was sort of dedicated to her, giving her a voice, giving her a sort of a spotlight to talk. And I think that's how Ahalya's Awakening came about. So I think that's sort of, it's talking about myself and talking about the book. So I think I'm quite sure you must have more detailed questions to ask.
We do. But I'm going to do let the participants actually do that in the form of discussing the book versus I'm sure they have a lot of questions for you also. So I'm going to step out a little bit and hand it over to Neha. She's going to hold the session through, conduct the session. And I'm sure they have a lot of questions also coming over. So over to you, Neha.
Thanks, Deep. Thanks a lot. Hi, Kavita. Happy New Year again.
Hi, Neha.
Yeah, you know, we are so glad to have started this year with your book. We all have been a huge fan of yours. And coincidentally, the first discussion that we had on Meritive was on your first book, Karna's Wife.
Oh.
And that took off so well because there were only a few questions, but we, you know, discussed mythological fiction for almost an hour and a half. And then we really understood that this genre is a little bit different from what exactly people are, you know, usually write. Because we've seen mythology and we've seen fiction, but mythological fiction is something that is interspersed and you have taken it very well. And now that I'm observing all your books, I think you are particularly interested telling it from the woman's point of view, which is also very intriguing. So thank you for taking all this up, you know. And we all will just introduce ourselves. I mean, what exactly we are as a reader. And if we can, we can also ask a question. Everybody has lots of questions, but we'll limit to one question per person. And then we can start off with discussing about your book. Seems all right, right?
Yeah.
So Kavita, I'm just intrigued at what exactly made you go into this genre when it was not at all, not explored at all. And at that point of time, even these characters, I mean, I think Kavita's wife is also a fictional character. So what exactly, how exactly, I mean, how do you go on your research and then add your fiction? I'm just curious about it.
Okay, I think I'll just sort of split it into two. The first part is why I took mythology. As I mentioned earlier, I was sort of familiar with mythology as a literary technique, as a literature student, because while doing, if you read all the, most of them have the literary allusions are from mythology, very strong references from, it could be Greek mythology, Norse mythology, whatever. Most of the authors use it as a metaphor, a complete running metaphor in the poem, whether it's poetry or whether it's fiction. So I think, I was pretty familiar with our stories from the Ramayana and Mahabharata, essentially because I think because of Amar Chitrakatha, I mean, they make your introduced very early, and I sort of read them in detail. And when it was sort of a challenge for me. I said, let me see if I can actually deal with mythology, you know, in the sense, though mythology, I think, is a very wrong word to use. A story is a sort of a story from the ancient text, from the Ramayana, from the epics, and sort of use it as a canvas to contemporize. And contemporize it not with with the issues and with the views, rather than having a contemporary setting. You know, I was sort of contemplating to have a contemporary setting as a modern setting, but then I said, no, I know there is a certain old world charm, there is a certain freedom where an opportunity where you get to talk about the layers through mythology. Because mythology, I think that we really sort of dismiss it as just a legend, as so. Folklore or some ancient story, but it is definitely, I think, we take it too lightly. I think it's like we sort of keep it at the level of Amar Chitrakatha itself, in the sense it's not just a katha, it's not a little tale, tiny tale. It has very strong significance, not only in the overall narrative, that particular episode, but it has a very significant philosophical and moral depth, which most mythology many times do not have, you know, the relevance which it has today. Why are these stories still popular today? Why do we like to keep hearing and, you know, keep on hearing those stories again? Of course, we're familiar with it because of by reading it or through our family, your grandmother might have told you. You know, there's so many, I mean, most of our names around us have some reference to our epics, and they are definitely drawn from there. So I think mythology was the selected genre, and I wanted to tell the story of Karna, but not through his eyes. You know, I wanted to tell his story by a woman. And here I think I wanted to really clarify, because here I did not want to glorify at all. This whole thing, people think that I've glorified Karna. I don't think I've glorified Karna at all in this book. In fact, I've seen it as a completely grey character because we see him as a white noble, you know, he's sort of a victim of circumstances. No, he was much more. He was much more than that. And I think, as a man, he should have been. He should have overgrown or overthrown that particular angst which he had, and eventually never happened, because it's like a thorn by his side. So I think this sort of a torn, tortured man, and a complex man. You know, eventually he is going to be a complex character. So to live with such a man, and what was the life with him, with a para? He was a social para, of course. I mean, I'm not denying that. But this whole, there was no element of glorification in him, because what happens when a bad man is in a good situation? You know, this whole concept of definition of a good man and a bad man. You know, that is exactly which I wanted to remove. This white and black, the entire ambiguity between, I wanted to, you know, we have sort of stereotyped the white and black characters. And there is, and actually our epics are talking, especially the Mahabharata is talking about characters which are not white and black. They are shades of grey. They are definitely shades of grey, because there are situations where a certain good character does behave in a unexpectedly bad way, you know, or a bad character, suddenly you see his softer side or something. So I think this, we have very hurriedly and very easily slipped them into these stereotypes, which, and I think Karna is one of, again, Karna has been stereotyped, yeah, either as a bad man or a good man. I mean, so it was not either of them, he was both. And what was the both? So I think that's how Karna's wife became the narrator of his story. And she is definitely like a sutradhar, where his story is told without any bias, without the love or loyalty expected from a wife. So she becomes his most severe critic, and accordingly she takes certain actions, and then how eventually the whole aspect of war, violence and forgiveness, and you know, which are sort of the collaterals in a war, we never see that. So I think all these aspects were definitely involved in Karna's wife. And then I moved into a more softer shade, like Sita's sister, where, and then I think the success of Karna's wife actually gave me the courage to write Sita's sister, in the sense Urmila is not much
spoken about.
I think there's nothing. I mean, we are talking about research here. There's nothing about it. I mean, there were just 4-5 lines mentioned when, and then I started reading upon about her. I found some threads, folk threads, where she sort of paints during those 14 years. You know, she's an artist. So I tried to join the dots, tried to make a story, weave a story around her, essentially through the characters of Sita and Lakshmana. So the Urmila in my mind, I think I suddenly fleshed her out the way I wanted her to, because I think she is my most favorite character. In the sense, we don't know anything about her. And I think that's how the first journey about knowing overlooked character came about. Because Urvi was a fictitious character. Urmila was the first step where I started searching for such characters. And it happened unconsciously, because while doing research for Sita's sister, I stumbled upon Menka, you know. So when you're talking about research, I mean, actually the research, one of the advantages of continuous research is that you keep on meeting, getting acquainted with characters which might be possible, have a possible potentiality of the next book. Because, of course, there are thousands of characters there. I mean, that way, I think I'm very lucky, or we all lucky to have all these characters around us. To make a book out of them, a 300-page book, that, I think, there I have to be a little more selective. So I think while doing Sita's sister, I selected Menka, and that's how Menka came about. Essentially, again, there was a line, I think, which said that it was one of the most torrid romances. And when I said read torrid romance, I thought it was sort of a one-night, a one-night situation with them. And then I realized it was a full 10-year relationship. So it was definitely not okay. Ho gaya, chalo jao, you know, raat gayi baat gayi sort of a episode at all. And then these 10 years, what did she do with Vishwamitra, a person whom she was meant to destroy? You know, this whole concept came about, the sort of the cultural context also about an apsara, who else, who is an apsara, you know? Do we look beyond her beauty? Her beauty is not her part of her personality. It's also it's a weapon, you know. The apsara use their beauty as a weapon. They are seductress who are meant to either seduce some powerful man, be it a rishi, be it a king, and when they do their job, they go back to heaven. The job done, and they go. It's almost like an assignment, you know. They have. So, I think I wanted to see the women in Menaka, because they are also, besides being seductresses, they are lovers. They become wives. They become mothers. So they experience every aspects of womanhood, and yet they are denied to enjoy the full. So they are not meant to enjoy it. They are not supposed to experience those emotions either. So you know. So again, Menaka again becomes a very not only a complex character. She becomes a hidden character. You know, you don't know anything about apsaras at all. Besides, they have these very colorful stories about them. Be it Menaka, be it Urvashi, be it Ramba. So, and they, of course, the first people to be cursed. So you know, always the victim of some curse or the other. So. I think that's how I think Menaka was. I think when it came out, I think there was a lot of the research. Again, as coming back to your question, the research was essentially through Vishwamitra, which is a huge character. There's nothing about Menaka. There's more about Vishwamitra and again about Shakuntala, but not much about Menaka. She just is again, she sent for that errand. She sent on that errand. She comes back, and that's when she abandons her daughter. You know, this, it's a very 3-line description of her. So research, what I'm trying to say about here is the research is, of course, is ongoing. It even when I'm writing, I keep on researching, because every chapter, whether it's at a general level, generally as such, and when it comes to each chapter wise, you know, keep on referring, because stories, one story which is there, let's say in the Ramayana, which is mentioned, it does get changed in the Mahabharata, and then in the Purans is completely a different way. So there, within itself, there are different versions in it, besides the other versions through the centuries. So sort of sieving out all these versions, reading about them, wondering which one to really pick up as a thread and make it a complete cohesive whole. I think that is also a part of research, because eventually I have so much of matter on me that I have to sieve it and make it into a sort of rational whole. You know, it's sort of joining the dots and getting a plot structure to the narrative. So I think research, so that's how, I mean, whether it's Satya later on, whether it's Surpadaka and then Satyavati or Ahilya, I think they were all, eventually these stories, these are the women I came across, and somehow or the other I sort of listed them. Okay, I'll write a story about them sometime or the other. So. It's an ongoing thing. Research, in fact, I think I end up doing more of reading and collecting material than actually writing per se. The writing is relatively takes a shorter while. It's sort of defined whether it will happen in 5 months. But I think research is, like, even if I'm getting bored, I'll just read a story and just pick up a story from and see what. Because one story is interviewed with the other, you know, it's sort of interlaced. It's like a chain. It's like a fabric. It's almost like a, like a web, we sort of get you in. So I think that's what research is for me. So it's the stories, you cannot have one point of view here, because this whole what we are trying to say here is the power of the alternative perspective, where one story is told, but the moment the perspective changes, the story, of course, the narrative is the same, but the story definitely does change, is seen through a different complete viewpoint, and how the story can also, you can see the same thing in a different light, in a different realization, and hopefully a realization which makes the reader think and not really sort of reduce it to a judgment, which we often do. We sort of dismiss every character. No, as I said, he's good or bad, you know, she's this or that. So instead of just doing that, going beyond the prejudices and biases, through you know, see it in a more egalitarian, more democratic way, the characters.
Yeah. So this basically summarizes, you know, all the books that you've written in such a present way. Thanks. And I think the research really shows in all your books, because without research, there are so many facts and, you know, stories to be intertwined that you couldn't have written without just, you know, the story came and you couldn't write that. So, okay, I'll just briefly tell about myself. I've been reading for the past 20-25 years, and recently we opened a book club where we meet and have quizzes and, you know, we discuss books of the month. Of course, the last year it was entirely virtual, but we still are not, we have not left reading the book. So this is a very fun process. So I'll hand it over to Gunjan, who will introduce herself, and then she can ask you one simple question.
Hi, this is Gunjan here. I just had one small question for you. After thought about Karna's wife, and you took on Urmila, and then Menka, and Ahalya, and everyone, and I just realized that you have taken women from history who had no voice. So while writing these books, did you ever face the issue that people coming up and telling you that, you know, you were playing with history, or you were diluting it in some manner? Or even, I think some would say, use the word of giving it a feminist color, because these women in our history, in the stories that we read of, are never given any importance. And you have given them a voice about them in detail. You know, you have fleshed out their characters so beautifully. So did you come across this as a criticism or something?
No, I don't think I'll take it as a criticism. I'm essentially a very optimist person. I think I take it as an observation they have, and I think I take it because, yes, if these are again tags giving it a feminist color, or because we don't see these characters. They are, of course, I'm talking about women, and women, unfortunately, we don't recognize the women in our texts. You know, we know about Sita and Draupadi, but what would Mahabharata be without Kunti or a Gandhari, you know? These other women characters are equally important, because of course Sita and Draupadi are the protagonists, so, and they are themselves such as powerful, complex characters. But when you're talking about women, because we see these stories, we see mythology through the men's side, because they have been told by men, they are about men, and women somehow happen to be, of course, they are there, definitely they're just not queens and princesses. But they are women, and they are women, they are wives, they are mothers, they are sisters, they are avengers. So I think we see them. So seeing them in that light, I think, is very important. Because, and another part is, it's like even challenging tired stereotypes. I think that is, whether it's men or whether it's women, especially women, because since I'm writing about them, as I said, we see Apsara in a certain light, we see Surpanaka in a certain line, negative characters in a certain line, just or even Ahilya, you know, sort of immediately judge her as she is. So I think with a certain moral overtone. So these bold revisions of age-old archetypes, and, you know, so creating these brave new heroines. So yes, it is a feminist in that sense, because you see women as individuals, as persons of not only of society, persons who living in the family, living as you. So she is a woman first, not just a wife or a mother or a daughter or a princess or a daughter-in-law. So seeing her as an individual, I think, so there the feminism, for me, that is feminism. Because if there are two species in a human race, why don't we recognize the other one as much as the man? If there is a man, there is a woman. So see them together in the same, view them. The story is there. You have a hero, you are the heroine. But why does hero take, you know, the heroes and the men snatch away the story and the significance? And I think it was like reintroducing the women. And because women are marginalized at every level of society, besides literature, of course. I mean, I'm talking about this particular literature. And there are patriarchal assumptions. So I think these stories, actually, when you see in the original, like when you see the story of, especially see, most of them are for very feisty, strong women themselves. Unfortunately, they themselves have become mythology, and these stories have become a victim of patriarchy, because they have been distorted, diluted from their original. And there is a certain male perspective dominating over the stories. And so there is a gender bias discrimination. And so these, I think when I'm retelling that story, it's sort of revisioning, and I'm sort of reinterpreting them. So this this whole social attitude is sort of revamped, you know, where you're seeing it through more, as I said, more democratic eyes. You're seeing her as a person, as an individual. And she's telling a story, whether it's not about just being weak or a strong woman. I think everyone, given a situation, I think they do fight back. But the strength lies in them fighting back. I think that is very, very, I think that is what defines their strength, because there is a certain new paradigm, a sort of new ideal for women's consciousness, you know, because archetypes have changed definitions. They have changed definitions now. And we don't see Sita as what she is, or we don't see Draupadi. There is definitely more to Draupadi than being the wife of five husbands. So I think these sort of two-line definitions about women, which is often there, I think that's sort of expanded into a validation or the explanation of their life. And that's how, as to seeing them as individuals, sort of seeing them, it's sort of a rise of individualism even in them, you know. If you see the character like Devyani and Satyavati, and then sort of compared to the later characters like Kunti, Gandhari, or even Draupadi. And so there itself you see the arc where how you see a woman, the women in that society then and during those years, during that entire flow of the century. So you see the change, the social change, the political change, the cultural change. And I think the criticism I handle, because yes, I think I respect my readers too much. I think they know the difference between fiction and fact. They know, I think, I at least hope that when you read an Ahilya or a Satyavati, you'll go back to the original and see who the character actually is, you know. So there are so many versions of Ahilya, actually, if you see. Her story has been distorted so much from what the original, what Valmiki's Ahilya is, to what we see her today. That itself is an example of how patriarchy completely overruled her story, she as a person, she as a woman. And that is the story which, of course, I have sort of used, I mean, trying to expand this whole thing, where I have used, I have sort of lessened her divinity and increased, sort of made her more mortal, because mortals have flaws. And these flaws, you have to see her as a flawed character. She is not the perfect character. You know, this whole thing of, so I think this myth of perfection, which Ahilya means, you know, without a blemish, and ironically, that is the name of the. So see her beyond her, with her blemishes, you know, because she is blemish, she has her flaws, and that is what is there in all of us. So I think seeing and recognizing each other's flaws and not making it into a judgment, I think that is the most important part in most of this story.
Yeah, thanks, Kavita. Ruchira?
So your short question is the one answer.
I don't have a question for you. Hi, I'm Ruchira from Pune. So, do you mind if I can voice my opinion on this book? I'm very happy that you have made Indian, I don't like to use the term mythology, I like to use the term Indian history, so contemporary. And the way you filled out your women characters has been so impressive. I've followed all your books from the beginning. Mm-hmm. But Ahilya's book has been the most touching so far. Mm-hmm. Because the way you filled out her character, I don't know whether this comes only from imagination or I see a lot of experience and things that you absorb from your surroundings. Mm-hmm. That in a way you've portrayed many different lessons in this. Like, she is very beautiful. She's supposed to be the most beautiful mortal female. Mm-hmm. And yet she's not happy. So beauty does not give you happiness. It does not necessarily mean that it's going to make life easy for you. And at the same time, because of her beauty, her mind is not as appreciated as it should have been. And I feel that it was such a strong point. So I'm really thankful for you for putting that across. And I would love to know your thoughts about this. this particular aspect, like this particular aspect of a woman. We are all objectified. Yeah. I'm sure both of us have felt objectified at some point in life. But here is a character in Indian history who's probably been sidelined and objectified more than anybody else. So the character sketch, the thoughts, the conversations that she has are extremely interesting to me as a reader.
Thank you. I really love the way you put it across. Yes, and it's extremely touching when a reader sort of understands exactly the touching the chord of the author. He's trying to. Sorry, my voice is not too. But yes, it is definitely colored by people around me, because when I see, I think that's what I said. It's such a universal story. We hear about romance, you know, the breaking of marriages, the disappointment in marriages, extramarital affairs. We see all this around us, and we are the first one to judge. We are so quick to judge. And here we are talking about a beautiful woman. Now, when you're talking about beauty, I think that is, we never see that. We are talking about objectification. But I think one of the big tragedies of beautiful women or a pretty face is that is never taken seriously. Very honestly, because when you say beauty is skin deep, yes, but they actually literally people take it as skin deep. They do not realize a beautiful woman has a heart, she has a brain. So her beauty, it becomes very restricting. You know, she is, I think it happens in a personal life, even in a professional life. I mean, if you see a beautiful, intelligent woman, the whole perception is very different of her. So here I was talking about beauty as, is she supposed to be beautiful? As you said, she's very unhappy because she wants to be looked beyond that. She's not just a pretty face. And I think it starts from the moment she's born. You are beautiful. And it happens. It happens with a pretty child. It always happens, you know. And instead of getting flattered and getting vain about it, which most of us would do, I think she, for her, there is, it starts actually that sense of restlessness starts from there, that she is not seen or defined beyond her beauty. And I think that is the very foundation of her friction with, not only with herself, with her family, with her husband, with, you know, I think that is how, that's what I said. I wanted Ahilya not as a divine character, not as Brahma's creation, which again becomes a symbol of perfection. But see her as a woman. And I think I wanted people to see Ahilya as a woman of today, because it is such a modern, it is still there. You see this problem in this thing. If we are not talking about just infidelity and the penalty for infidelity, which sort of the story has been reduced to, you don't see Ahilya as the woman she is at all. A girl who wants to, you know, we talk about desire. We sort of, again, limit desires to only sexual desires. She has a desire to prove herself in the first place. Her desire for education, her desire to succeed, her desire for knowledge, her desire of her whole to know the world, you know, and that is one of the reasons why she's attracted to Gautam. She thinks that she would get that world by marrying him. And when that marriage becomes a disappointment for some reason, there are different reasons. And then how? So I think Hilda's story here again, it's a story of us, you, me, all the people, of girls or women around us. And I think here again, I was not judging Gautam at all. I mean, Gautam definitely doesn't turn out. Again, I think he's extremely sort of straight-jacketed as an old rishi who cursed his wife. No, I think no husband likes to see his wife. he actually catches her in the act. So. I mean, if you see his point of view, he is going to be the enraged husband. So he's not going to. But here the main question was, it takes two people in a marriage. And we sort of see only she as condemned. So did he realize his mistake? Why did your wife stray? If she has strayed, why has she strayed? Oh, this is also on the husband. So the husband needs to be asked this question. The men need to be asked in marriage. Even men need to be asked this question. So I think we sort of put the entire onus of marriage on the woman. We put the entire onus of motherhood, being a parent, again on the woman. I mean, her kids, they do not side her. They don't stand by her till the end. So in the what eventually, she's no longer a wife. She's no longer a mother. She realizes she was just a woman. She was not. She was her definition, she was not just the, okay, whether she is the devoted wife or the unfaithful wife, whether she is a good mother or a bad, neglectful mother. Now, these sort of questions which society still demands from women. And this is sort of question which we all go through. I mean, whether in some point of time, whether when you're working, whether you're in your house, it starts from there. You know, you're always plodding through this question. You have these questions in your mind. So this whole question of, she has everything. She is perfect in the sense she is beautiful, she is intelligent, she is a good person. She's a good person, she's kind, she's empathetic girl. And still, she doesn't have the world under her feet. You know, she is. I mean, you think she has everything, but she eventually loses everything. So I think this is the story of, she is not an extraordinary person. That is what I'm trying to say. We have to, Ilya in our mind is someone who is extraordinary. No, she's an ordinary person with her ordinary desires of a person, of a man. I mean, if Gautam is ambitious, so is she. But you only see Gautam's ambitiousness is because he becomes higher. He becomes a Maharishi. He becomes a Maharishi. But what about Ahilya, his wife, who was responsible for his career rise also, which is there in most, I mean, if you see all the Rishis, their wives were responsible for the status they had gained. They are different. When you talk about Vashishta, there is an Arundhati. So women, the wives were very important. And Ahilya is the only one who actually breaks that mold, you know, because of a certain episode. And what was that episode? I think what is so amazing about this story is actually when you're talking about contemporary sensibilities here, but yeah, a Valmiki could think of this story that many years ago, and he was actually trying to say the same thing, that in a marriage, the man is as responsible in marriage as a woman. So it is not, she is not, the whole onus is definitely not on her. I think that is what I was trying to convey, where if you talk, it is, because marriage, there is a egalitarian, there is an equal responsibility a man has. And we never see the man's responsibility. We never ever see it.
So right, Kavita. But I think even here, Ahilya was more ambitious in the sense she wanted, you know, all the knowledge. And that is the reason she was after him to be taught as well. So maybe, I don't know, I believe in...
No, I'll just interrupt you. Of course, this is part of the fiction I've added. She was asking, the previous question was it a there was how much of fiction? Yes, this was part of fiction because I wanted her to be seen more than a Rishi's wife and Indra's lover. You know, so the whole thing, who is she? Because that is what her identity is. She's either his Rishi's wife or she is the condemned woman. So how does she, why would a girl, young girl, be attracted, get married to an old Gautam Rishi? Why would he? I mean, it starts from there. Would not a girl choose Indra if she had a choice? He's young, handsome, powerful. She would. Then why did she choose him? So I think the whole thing about the story was going backward. And yes, there I think there was a lot of fiction where being a Rishi's wife, the wife is supposed to be, have a very exceptionally strong emotional and intelligent quotient. So yes, and I think Ahilya filled that blank. Yeah, continue with the question.
Yeah, so I just, this was rather than a question, it is just my observation. I believe that, I believe in karma. So I think she ultimately got her redemption, or you may say awakening, by Gautam cursing her. So you know, what was going to happen, happened eventually, because ultimately that is the reason that Gautam cursed her. That is my deduction.
Yes, because many times in retrospect, we do realize if something, you know, something good happens from the bad.
Correct.
It happens in life. You know, we don't realize at that particular point of time. And here again, I say, yes, this is the whole book is, it took a longer time for me to write this book because I put a lot of personal experiences through people around me. And it happens because when the first thing is there's anger and there's resentment for what has happened. But in retrospect, you realize whatever bad has happened, you learn from them, you sort of grow out of it and you evolve. So I think Ahilya, that curse actually turns out to be her blessing, because she gets her freedom, she gets her enlightenment, she gets her introduction to herself through that very curse. And I think in a way, as a perceptive husband, I think Gautam realizes where he tries to, I think I was trying, I mean, this is my interpretation. I think Gautam realizes at that point that since he has erred, he has erred in the sense of not just beside, just not being. He has betrayed her in some way, and I think that was his way of. It was his redemption also. That's why I did not want them coming back together, because they are changed people. They are more mature people when they part ways. So they love each other. So marriage is not just about love at all. Right. It's about respect. Right. It's about trust. Trust is very important. And of course, that's very strong mutual respect we have for each other. So I think all this is there, and it remains in their marriage. So that way I would say, though they don't live together, I think that they are wiser people by the end of it.
Definitely, definitely. Lekha.
Hi, I'm Lekha. Hi, Kavita. I have a question. Like in this book, you have beautifully portrayed the character of Sachi. Okay, I have never heard about her. In every book I have seen that, like in Sita's sister, you have shown the character of other sisters also, even if it was from the voice of Urmila. So what is the inspiration behind it? Means how you know that you want to portray her that, like Sachi, in that way, in the book?
Sachi was, I think, the other. She's sort of a contrast. Can you hear me?
Yeah.
She's sort of a contrast. She's a contrast to Ahilya, literally, because... if Indra sees Ahilya as an obsession, she herself is obsessed with him. So it is, and again, you know, it's like if she's ice, she's fire, you know, this whole. So she was essentially created, of course, she is his wife. And the position of a wife, and a wife who knows that her husband is attracted to another man. And this is the story of Sachi continuously. I mean, you see this. So I think I wanted to show her plight, her situation, and what she, you know, to live with a man who is obsessed with another woman. I mean, that again I find pretty, I observe it pretty often in the families around me. You know, you see this where one of them is, you know, it is sort of an unequal relationship where the husband loves the wife more or the wife loves the husband more. And I'm not talking about just marriage, I'm just talking about relationship. And the entire sword or the shadow of a past relationship into the present one. I think Sachi actually represents that, you know, where I'm putting it in very modern terms, where the role of the ex in the present relationship, it defines the current relationship. It does spill over. How much of it do you allow it to influence you? How much do you... So I think Sachi was that, and the fact that she was this whole, that she was an Asur's daughter, and again we have sort of stereotype Asur's into her. And she was the daughter of an extremely enlightened, again a very enlightened king, her father was, and then she marries the king of the Devas, they were the arch enemies of the Asur. So with such a baggage, she herself sacrifices. There's so many personal sacrifices, personal conviction. I think the conversation between the two sisters is exactly that she eventually, she's marrying a man who is responsible for the father's death. So she has so much of, not only baggage, she carries so much of guilt, so much of grief with her, which she actually doesn't have time to experience because she is so much in love with this man. So I think how a woman... sort of suppresses her guilt and grief for love, with the hope of love, you know, with that hope of the power of the emotion she has for that man, and she hopes that it will be reciprocated sometime or the other. And I think eventually her realization. So there was one of the reasons that Sachi was not sort of tapped later on, but it didn't matter because I think before that she has already come to a conclusion that. There is a relief in her mind when she actually meets Ahilya that her husband might be having so much of, he might be obsessed with Ahilya, but Ahilya has nothing for him. You know that it is not jealousy, it's not just plain jealousy. The jealousy, she's trying to analyze her jealousy each time because she is an intelligent woman, she is an extremely beautiful woman. Then what is wrong with her? You know, this whole question. And that gives a sense of, so many times you've seen beautiful, successful women sort of completely reduced to a mass of insecurity just because of this one feeling that you are not good enough for that man. Why? You don't need to be that. You have to rise up. You know, so I think Saatchi actually represents that feeling where it doesn't matter. You are what you are much. You, in fact, he doesn't deserve you. When you see a Saatchi and a Indra, Saatchi doesn't deserve any. She definitely deserves someone better than Indra. You know. So I think this Saatchi was the other side of. It was not just a triangle. It was two triangles actually. If you see. So the other side, it was almost like a square, you know, when you put two triangles together and then you see the whole picture as an entire square. So she was one of the four sides. She is a very important side, which is reflecting a certain emotion, a certain weakness of emotions, I would say, which has started, which completely take over her and sort of weakened her and sort of reduced her to a to almost self-pity, you know, she becomes, she is becoming a little hysterical, she is becoming a little obsessive herself, she is becoming neurotic, all because of this, you know, she's suspicious, see, this whole thing is only because of this one man in her life, when she actually is not such a person. So I think she would be, she can term her as, she's an ex, you can be the ex, you can, she can be the present. She is actually the conscience of Indra. He is eventually answerable to her, and in the end, he does go to her. In his worst plight, in the end, he goes to her, goes back to her, and she accepts him. So I think that is what, again, these are the intricacies or the, what do you say? Lot of emotions and relationship. It shows that we cannot sort of define or measure relationship, you know, what happens now, what will happen. You don't plan anything. So what this entire Saatchi and Indra, if you see, it's extremely tempestuous, almost vitriolic sort of a relationship. But yes, it is there. I mean, in his worst state, he goes back to her. He cannot go back to Ahilya. Ahilya is gone. So this treating the woman as she is, you know, your wife, this whole role of a wife, the lover, I think, as I said, it's not just a triangle. These are all definitions which come in the gamut of different relationships. So I think Saatchi was just one aspect of that entire element.
Yeah, great. I'm sure Lekha must have got, and you have very beautifully portrayed, you know, all the female characters, actually, Kavita. They have many complex layers to them. Suvarna, you have any question? Or we can go ahead with the other questions.
Hi, Kavita. This is Suvarna. And I think I have, you know, appreciated your book many times enough in, you know, in my Instagram page and all, even in Marathi also. I just wanted to ask you a question. So there was a moment in the book at the end when, you know, Gautam catches Indra and Ahilya together. And then, mm-hmm. you know, Indra tells Gautam, you know, just forgive me, let me go and all. And Ahilya just gives a laugh to herself at that particular moment. I mean, maybe thinking that what kind, that all men are like the same and all men want the same thing, or a different kind of a weird laugh which she gave. So I just want to know, what was your thought process in that moment? Like, what did you introspect or interpret in that moment of what Ahilya would be thinking about both the men in the life?
Yes, I mean, if you're talking in the moment, I think it is that it's a double realization for her. A, that she's been, see, there is a, it becomes a flux of emotions here. A, she's caught back foot. She's literally caught. There's a guilt. There is guilt because her husband has caught her. There is a certain element of defense, self-defense. And the realization, the man whom she expects something from this certain episode or from the man, from Indra. And then she realizes, no, he is as shallow, worse than what she thought of him before. So this, it is also their self deprecation, because this whole, a woman who is caught on the back foot, or any person, I think this whole, there is fear, there is uneasiness, there is anxiety, there is guilt, there is, the most important emotion would be defense, you know. And actually, if you see Ahilya, she doesn't defend at all. In the there is no defense at all. She sort of condemns immediately. And I think all these emotions are just sort of racing through her. Because you can't sort of still freeze a certain thought which is there. You know, it's sort of just like her mind is sort of flooded with all these emotions. Or her heart is also flooded with all the thoughts. I mean, it's an iron age, two different. So, and when they clash, when they are sort of, it's like a storm. It's a storm brewing in her. And it is going to explode. So I think there, it is beyond judgment. It is beyond redemption. It is beyond any retribution. It is just undistilled thoughts, you know, which are just filtering into her mind. And she's reacting. She's reacting. She's talking to herself. So I hope I could sort of, I did a sort of reveal the plight which a woman, which Ahilya is in. So I think all I can say is that these, I think it's, name any emotion, I think she must have felt it at that particular time. Right from disappointment to guilt and love. And it happens. I mean, I just hope I was sensitive enough to reveal the whole story at that particular. And that is the, that is actually Ahilya's story. That single episode, that event is what defines her. It defines her, defines her future. So at that particular way, she has no words for self-defense. But there are, actually she has a lot of to, because if you are talking about this particular event, there is a reason why this incident has happened. And that again becomes questions she wants to ask Gautam. You know, when Gautam is talking to Indra, and the thoughts are also that Gautam, she also realizes that Gautam is also responsible for this situation. Just like Indra is responsible for the situation and she is responsible for the situation. So all three are equally guilty, equally accountable for this. But eventually it is one person who is sort of giving out the judgment and giving out the penalty.
Right. So I believe everybody, have been done with asking a question. Actually, Kavita, we have a format wherein we have written down 8 questions. Mm-hmm. And I'll be taking up one question each. Usually, we will just discuss a couple of points on each, or my views on each question. But I believe almost all the discussions have been done till now. Nevertheless, we'll go ahead. So the first question would be, this book shows the story of a girl who doesn't want marriage and doesn't dream of a prince to marry and settle down. Was it surprising to think that Ahilya was so different in her thinking considering the era she was born in? So I personally feel, as you have written in the book, that right from the beginning, Ahilya was different. She never dreamed of, you know, getting a prince and settling down in an ordinary mundane life, or she never wanted what the other princesses want. So that was very clearly mentioned. Only thing I found it surprising was in the era that she was born, this was very different. So she really, gave importance to her brains rather than her beauty, which is also mentioned many times in the story ahead.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
Shall I answer this? I think this question, the reason why I made her like this was, it starts from the original story where you see, if you see the story of Ahilya, it's like she was created by Brahma, and then she was given to Gautam without asking her opinion. I mean, this whole question starts from there. Did she really want to be with Gautam Rishi? She was sort of handed over to Gautam Rishi as his wife after that Swayambar. So what was her opinion? What was her choice? What was her feelings? Did she want to get married to him? You know, so here I sort of expanded it into a dilemma, a modern day dilemma, where a girl wants more than just marriage. And that, so in a way, that Ahilya is definitely a very, very, very contemporary version of what I see of Ahilya, because I think the story of Ahilya starts the entire dilemma, the entire question about her story starts from the fact that she is going to get married. Does she want to marry Rishi, the Gautam Rishi, in the first place?
Right. Gunjan, your views?
I just feel that, because Ahilya was throughout, struggling with the fact that she wanted people to look beyond her beauty. Mm-hmm. And this is we know what we know of the era is from what we have read, and mm-hmm. a lot of people, like, for the first time Kavita has brought out that thing, that what a woman was actually feeling. Maybe if you know, stories were written from the women's point of view, we may have known of more women not wanting to get married and do something else with their lives. Unfortunately, all the stories in that era show that women were made for matrimony only, or you know, and working for the benefit of their husband. They are hardly given any space to talk, or their characters are not developed that well. So I feel because of the way the stories are told, we find Ahalya an exception, but maybe I'm very sure Kavita will write more such books that she
No, I think what I was trying to, I think that is why I've seen shown Gautam Rishi giving examples of Rishikas who were not married, who, you know, pursued. That is not fiction, definitely. That is part of, there are such cases where there are definitely Rishikas who did not marry and who sort of. So I think, again, as we see, we only see one slice of life, which has been against stereotype. Mm-hmm. And we've not seen. So Ahalya, of course, was perhaps not that sort of a person, but I made her out to be like that because she has to match the background of Gautam Rishi. Because that is, he's the one who is giving examples. Be it in his family or other women during that era. And he's, ironically, he is talking about women's rights and women's legal status. Mm-hmm. So in this, that is definitely not fiction. He was working on all that. So we don't see this. That's what, as I said, we don't see many of these. We don't see this slice of life at all. We don't even know about Rishikas. We only know about the Rishis. But besides Rishikas, even the wives of the Rishis were equally... They had a very important role, not in their husband's life, but in the ashram. And ashrams were education, not just education. It was a family. It was a family of that many children, you know. So it was the Rishi and his wife were not the guru. Beside the guru, they were the mother and father, the parents of the children who were studying there. So,
right. So Ahalya also maintained the Gurukul very well.
Yes, I mean, there were so many people who... if you see instances of all Gautam's disciples, there is a story. There are long stories. They are successful. And how Ahalya also was part of it. You know, that's what Rishi sort of reduced her only to that particular episode, which is very sort of defines her, which sort of unfortunately it becomes a defining moment for her.
Right. Ruchira?
So what I found very interesting about Ahalya, I mean, everybody was trying to get her married off, was the first thought that came to mind was, in 10,000 years or so, nothing seems to have changed. We are a very privileged lot. We are coming here and talking about women's rights and how about women empowerment and feminism. But if this was the scenario 10,000 years ago, there are so many women who are still forced into marriage. So yes, even if you read it in the contemporary context, like, there may be 1% of women who have the right to choose their own spouses or their partners in life, while the rest of them pretty much have it the same way. So even if you call it a patriarchal interpretation or the kind of society we live in, it's very valid in today's day and age. And I feel that's why Indian stories and Indian history and the way you are putting them across to the newer generation, it makes a lot of sense to women who are reading it today, or to men who are reading it today also, that, listen, have we really progressed in these thousands of years? Because you're still suppressing a woman. You are, anybody who voices her thoughts is still considered arrogant and outspoken and blah, 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 so many things, rude, et cetera, et cetera. So
no, then their feminist becomes a bad word, you know, that, oh, she's a feminist, you know? I mean, many times, I mean, it's so sad that the whole world has been so, distorted beyond repair.
But that's what it was. Like, I am assuming that our Vedic times and what the Upanishads say, that women had the right to choose their own professions and they were not tied down by matrimony. And it doesn't necessarily need to be a tied down thing, right? You can progress together also in a relationship, but the role women are expected to play is pretty much the same. You're supposed to, like, if we are educated, we are able to have our own careers. We belong to a certain set of people who are more liberated, but the general class, I don't think their lifestyle has changed much.
No, we don't realize. We don't realize that patriarchy is so internalized. I mean, it's not about men patriarchy. Women who are patriarchy. So this whole choice, the pressure comes both from the man and the woman in the family for a whole. So it is not patriarchy, not just about men. Men don't practice patriarchy. It can be perpetuated by women also, because these thoughts, this patriarchy has been internalized and we don't realize it. So this whole is almost like a social conditioning. It's a family conditioning which has happened, and it is going to be there. It is there. But the thing is, how much, I mean, see the journey. I mean, we are still going on. We are struggling. And I think this basic thing of right to education, your right to study, to right to choose your life partner, I mean, these are decisions which you have to make. A girl has to make, but she's not given that opportunity. So we are talking, it's not about just being privileged. I mean, she
portrayed as such a empathetic character. Rishi Gautam over here is such an understanding man. He's actually trying for women's rights. So it's very ironical the way things turn out eventually.
Because eventually, I think he becomes a husband and not a woman. Because that's what happens. I think it's not just a husband. It happens in every relationship where you take the other person for granted. It does happen. I mean, be your husband, where you be a very over-familiar relationship. You too. I mean, it's not about man versus women here at all. Take your siblings, take your parents, anyone who is closer. You take so when what you are, what you appear to the world is very different from what you are, how you are to your family members. So I think Gautam is actually a classic case of that, where he might be a guru to the world, but he refuses to be a guru to his own wife.
True, true. I think we have another question also based on this same point, where, you know, this was discussed. Okay, so on the first question. You're...
Neha, we do not
hear you. Okay,
we could not hear you.
Am I audible now?
Yes.
So, Lekha, you can go next.
Yeah, what I think that she comes from an era when there was femur and no woman was allowed to choose a person. And whoever wins some contest, and he gets a wife. But mm-hmm. I think given a choice, no woman would have married and they must have some ambitions. Every woman has ambitions, not in this time and that time also. So I feel given a choice, all other women who have swimmer and got married that time, they may not have got married and wanted to study or go on with their life without getting married. So this is surprising for Ahilya, but I feel it holds good for everyone of that era.
You want me to expand on this?
Yeah, you can do that.
As I said... this is my interpretation of Ahilya. I mean, as I said, being a Rishi's wife, that is how I sort of portrayed her. But yes, because these are the questions I wanted to tackle. You know, I wanted answers. I have no answers. These are questions I just want to, these are issues I wanted to sort of show that, as she said very rightly, that things haven't really changed. Or have things worsened, if not... change for the better. So I think these are questions I just wanted both my readers to think and talk about. Is not only women, especially men, where the right for education, where it starts from the parents. The parents decide that, and the question of marriage again. You know, the whole decision making power. I think the whole issue out here was how much choice, it's not only about choice, how much decision do we allow, you know, the girl child to really have in her own life? So be it education, be it marriage, be it anything. So I think, as she said, we are the fortunate or privileged few who do manage to get it. But largely, if you see, these issues are not even, they're completely overruled. If a girl even asks these questions, even talks about it. And it, especially, that's why I got this whole concept of the brother in it. You know, there are different rules for a boy, and there are different rules for a girl. How things are much smoother for her brother will deal with us, and for her it becomes a struggle. So though she is, of course, as you say, the pampered, privileged princess, that's what the world sees her as. You know, but then she is struggling. She is a struggling person, and she is fighting for what she wants, but then she's not getting it. And you know, so I think yes, definitely, it's this is, as I said, this is the way I interpreted Ahilya, because I saw her. You know, she's if you see her, she's constantly fighting. She's strong, constantly striving. She's like a woman. She's like a drowning woman, you know, sort of reaching out and trying to. She wants to be saved, and she has to save herself. So eventually, that concept of the fact that she saves herself is eventually, in the end, when that realization comes that she is not answerable to anyone. She is on her own. So I think that is the crux of Ahilya.
Right, Suvarna.
Yeah, so as per the question, it was not surprising for me to see, you know, Ahilya being so strong and she was earning to study. So all this thing was not so surprising, because as you see, even in the original tales of Mahabharata or Ramayana and all, when you see different characters of, you know, Sita's sister or Sita or Draupadi and all, those women are portrayed strong even in the original story. So I was kind of expecting, with the title itself or with the book itself, like, you know, even Ahilya would be written in the same way, and maybe she was also. But I was quite, you know, it was quite not unusual also that, you know, those were the times when women were written like that, be it Draupadi, Ahilya or anybody, but still the men's thinking was the same. I mean, even till today, how the thinking is very narrow, and most men used to think that women's place is at home, or they need not study, they should just get married and all. So even at those particular times, the men were like that, but still the woman's thinking and all is very fast forward, and they always wanted to study than getting married or anything. Be it any character we take, be it Ahilya or any character we take in that kind of era. So that was so that I was kind of expecting from this book, when, you know, when I saw the title or when I saw the blurb, that, you know, it would be that kind of character, because I only know like one part when I read the Ramayana, that Ahilya was, you know, transformed with the touch of Rama's feet. But what was the backstory, nobody writes. So I was kind of expecting, and that this kind of, she might have been this kind of a woman who was, you know, having a lot of wisdom and, you know, wanted much more than a marriage in her life.
Here I would like to say, because this whole thing of we asking a girl or a woman asking for, or struggling to get free education or marriage or whatever, the thing is, I always see, when you have a girl and a boy as your children, you are giving it to a boy. Why are you not giving it to a girl? Why does it have to be a struggle for a girl? I think the whole question was that we are talking about a human race. We are talking about a man and a woman. Why is it that the woman, because these rights have been taken away from her, and then she's fighting for those rights. When we are talking about equal rights, yes, because there are two species in a human race. So if a man has it, why can't a woman? And here I'm not talking about equality as being sameness. I don't think a woman wants to be like a man. She just wants the opportunities given to a man, give it to the woman, to give it to the girl. I think that is what Ahilya's story is. And it starts, that's what I said, it, because that's why I have the brother with her. So, you know, he gets it easy, she's not getting it easy. So, yes, as I said again earlier, it was the same issue which I'm trying to bring out now. I mean, it is definitely, that's what I said, it's a story, a Ilya story, the story of any other woman around us, you, any woman around us, where a girl has to struggle or she has to fight for her desire, you know. Then I mean, desire in a completely generic, general term. I mean, all any types of desires. So her desires remain dreams eventually in the end. So
yeah. I think that should answer everybody's questions, or rather opinions. Moving on to the next, but where is my achievement in that? Kavita, here I'm quoting all your quotes here, because there are many quotes I have also actually noted down. So this Ahalya asks with genuine puzzlement, it's not my talent, it's God's gift. Is this the basic reason that she was attracted to Gautam, even though Indra pursued her and literally lusted for her for such a long time? I think we already discussed this in detail also. I mean, she was never attracted to Indra basically because she was not attracted to physical attributes and she did not give importance to them. So I guess I will have to ask anybody, if anybody wants to ask a question on this particular quote or something, because all the major points have been covered.
Can you just repeat the quote? I didn't get it.
But where is my achievement in that? Ahalya asked with genuine puzzlement. It's not my talent, it's God's gift. And this quote, I think, is particularly important for all the women, you know, who think, okay, I have achieved something when they are beautiful. So this is also a mention to them, because where is their achievement? That was God's gift. What you do or what you accomplish on your own should be your achievement, you know, do your hard work.
So shall I talk on this?
Or I'll just ask, you know, anybody, if anybody has a question,
because I think I want to explain myself.
Right. So this,
So what you're saying is that she says that what is her achievement in this? So I think her mother somewhere has a conversation with her regarding this particular sentence in the book, in which her mother says that intelligence is also a God gift, and how you use it is your perspective. So intelligence is given to a lot of people, but how they use it and how they utilize that intellect is their responsibility. I really think that it's not like many people have very high IQ or many people have very low IQ. Most of us are born with average intelligence. How we use our willpower, how we use our power to study and to grow is what is important. And as far as beauty is concerned, you know, as much as we would like to sweep it under the carpet and say that intellect matters more, sometimes it gives people a stepping stone. It helps them to get noticed, to be heard. Of course, I don't think it can last for very long. I mean, it can be counterproductive too. It doesn't allow you to see beyond that. But many successful people gain a foothold into whatever they want to, because by virtue of their personality or their looks or whatever.
So here, Ruchira, I think Ahalya is being humble in the sense she knows she doesn't have to take a beauty for advantage. So that is a gift which is not, you know, in many women, because they use their beauty to achieve something, maybe.
I don't think, you know what, there's a difference in vanity and using your beauty to gain things. So she's also very I don't know, she's very insecure about herself, like she's not concerned about her physical.
She is, because she knows she always been.
Have you
guys
noticed this one thing, that when Ahalya is talking about her beauty and everything else, there also there's a touch of patriarchy. It's always women's beauty which is, you know, put under the scanner. Oh, she got that job because she looks that way. Or, oh, she did got this because she's... Aren't men attractive? Isn't Indra attractive to women because of the way he looks? I don't think so. They are thrown away by his intellect or anything. They are attracted to him because of his physique, because of his looks. But that is always underplayed, you know. And obviously, if women talked like the way men talked, what a hot chick or something like that, it is looked down. We can't stand on the street corner and start commenting on guys passing by, can we? Because that's the way society has built it up. So whereas men can do it, and it's made very convenient for them to do that. So when we say, yes, attractive people, attractive personality always does have an impact, you know. But on the other hand, like how Ahalya says that everybody has intelligence, God gives them intelligence, and how you use them is your true, how you use your intelligence is your true talent. I agree, because somebody may look very attractive, but maybe, you know, when you talk to them, they do not come across as somebody nice, or maybe you do not connect with them on an intellectual level, you will not continue that conversation most probably. So I feel it's a two-edged sword, where again, a big chunk, you know, for women being judged for just beauty. Like if you look at the beauty pageants also, women are there also, they are not just judged on their looks, there are questions asked to them and all. And then you have a certain muscle building, body building competitions for men, where they are only judged on their muscles and body. So their intelligence does not come into play at all. So why not judge that also? So I just feel, you know, it's a very patriarchal way of looking at things and commenting. Like it's, when people find it difficult to digest a woman's success, it's very easy to say, oh, you know, look at her, the way she dresses, or the way she looks.
Yeah, because the whole thing is that she has it all. You know, she has the brain, yeah. She has the beauty. So she got it easy. You know, therefore she got it easy. I mean, this whole... But I think these three characters actually, if Indra sort of symbolizes the beauty, the physical aspect of it, the lust part of it, Gautam is the intellectual, the mind. And Ahila is actually a mix of both. She has beauty and she has brains. And then the fight within her. You know, I think so these three, and these are the issues. You know, we talk about beauty, the objectifying of women. I mean the whole conversation where she says, would you like if you were married only for that? I mean, I think I remember in the beginning, there is a conversation between her and Indra about that. If men are objectified. So he doesn't mind it, you know, because he's vain enough because he loves it. The whole thing about being handsome, that is his only quality he can attribute to. The vanity, the vanity. So I think that brings out the vanity factor of beauty, you know, where beauty does lead to, so very often leads to vanity. And she is beautiful, but she is not vain. So I think that is the basic difference between Indra and Ahilya, where they are too beautiful and still there is no attraction. And vis-a-vis, she is an intelligent person and she is attracted to the intellectual, to the mind of Gautam Rishi, though he is not a physically attractive person. So, which I think this again is a dilemma many women do face. And there are women who like, it's a question of attraction. You can be attracted to the mind and not necessarily the flesh. So, there are two desires. As I said, desires, we sort of limit desires, but desires are so complex again.
Anybody else has questions on this, or we can move ahead?
No, I would just like to discuss Sachi's character. It was very interesting when we are talking about beauty and brains, because she has both and she really undervalues herself. Like, mm-hmm. she thinks that her beauty or her brains are only justified as long as Indra can see it. Yes. She doesn't value and appreciate herself till Ahilya doesn't point it out to her that you don't need anybody else to do that for you. You should be fulfilled in who you are and what you are.
I guess that happens with mostly all the women. We, you know, always underplay ourselves. We need the society's approval or the stamp to tell us, okay, we are this.
We need a society's approval. We need a family approval. We are so bothered about what our parents will say, what our siblings will say, what our friends will say, what the teachers will say. We are so bothered about that. And eventually, that's what I said. I was trying to explain Sachi's character. She has everything. She's an intelligent, beautiful woman. And she sort of reduced herself with her emotion, what she feels for Indra, you know. So that becomes...
She's also been equally mocked in history, right, as a jealous wife. She's always been this caricaturous jealous wife stereotype. Yeah. So, which is very sad.
She's supposed to be the goddess of jealousy, you know, that sort of a thing. Which is very sad. I mean, there's a reason for her to be like that. I mean, this whole thing of being the wife of a man like Indra, you know, a philanderer, definitely who has a... So, how it sort of kills the identity, the in that person. And I think Sachi is a character where if she has everything, she doesn't value anything else she has.
True. Okay, so guys, moving on to the next one. Again, this is a quote, Kavita. Education sees no gender, no bias, continued Gautam. If the Upanishads clearly declared that individual souls are neither male nor female, who are we to discriminate when educating men and women? Still, after all this is said, the world judges only women. Don't we all think so? So I would like to know your opinion on this also.
Mine?
Yeah.
Here I was, I think this was, it was like, it was very deliberate when he's talking of this, because he's giving examples of education and fidelity. And each one has one view, and after marriage, both of them change their view. You know, it's like how it happens, how we are hypocrites, not necessarily hypocritical. We also change our views through time and through experiences, through situations. So the conversation which these two are having then and then later, the experiences which life throws and how they react differently. So I think this was sort of a prelude. It was sort of a moral prelude to what was going to happen. So I think it started.
Correct. So this particular quote was for education, you know, when Gautam says there's no discrimination, yet when he says ki my education is more important than yours.
So it happened because the later on conversation is again about fidelity. So education and fidelity, both.
Correct.
So eventually what he does later sort of betray his very words.
Correct, hypocrite. Anybody has this view or wants to ask something on this?
I definitely have a view on this. I think this is very similar to modern situations where the wife is educated and she's career-oriented, and all of a sudden after marriage, so many people expect that you take a backseat for the children or for the house or for the parents or whatever it is. So I think it was a very good way of making it very contemporary. I think everybody will find something, some similar situation happening, either experienced yourself or somebody else experiencing it along with you. They also face a very typical 7-year itch, right, where there's nothing wrong with their married life, where there's nothing wrong with their children, their responsibilities, and the life is going quite smooth. But he is getting irritated with her and reducing her confidence. Maybe he was insecure. I really don't know what it was like, because she was intelligent. She could have done very well. So that is also it was a very catch-22 situation, which is very evident around us in our day-to-day lives too.
I agree with Ruchiya. You know, even when I read those lines, I had this feeling. I had two things that came to my mind. One, it spoke that the soul has no gender. And all our spiritual works talk about, you know, redeeming the soul and the benefit of the soul. Then why does gender become so important? When we are talking of something which is genderless, then why does suddenly the, you know, gender becomes so immensely important? And the other part was like how Ruchiya said, it's very contemporary also, because it is something that is still happening. So it's not something as if it has stopped, like people saying, oh no, I'll not marry a woman who's earning more than me. Education wise, she cannot be more educated than me. All these biases are still there. It's not like, you know, that we are done away with them. They are still there. They are, and we see them every single day in our lives. I think that was a very contemporary touch also, and I love the part about the soul having no gender. That was beautifully said.
Thanks, Gunjan. Anybody else to discuss on this? Or we can move ahead.
Yeah, I really like this quote. As Chua said, it's a individual souls are neither male or female, that thing. But in today's world also, we see that a woman is the parents are always in a hurry to get her married, not educate her. For Ahilya also, her mom was trying to get her married to Indra as soon as possible, because she knew that she will go after education if given a chance. So that was the thing which happens today also. And I think parents are the one who don't really understand the thirst of knowledge in women. I think it starts from when the girl is born. She's never asked, like, you want to study further in, like, today, like in many families, they always think from the day she is born that she has to get married and there is no need for education and she should get educated. Just for the, like, she should get educated to the extent that she gets a good crew. So when I read about this, I was really surprised to know that it is written in Upanishads. So I really don't understand that why we always say that we always follow Vedas, Upanishads, but why don't we follow all these? I think in a male-dominated society, we always take the part what suits men from Vedas. It's we don't take any part for women, which is for their benefit. So I feel that.
So I actually don't agree with that, because I feel that we can't blame the men for this. There are many men who are very supportive. It's not like they're not. And I like the way Kavita has portrayed Gautam in this book, because he's not a caricaturist male chauvinist. In fact, he's quite open to his faults and he admits them quite readily. So it's not only the men who are responsible for this, it's also the women. It's an equal, you need to step up and take responsibility. Women are also big judging factors over here, you know.
Yeah, in fact, more sometimes. So moving on to the next one, it is also stated, one, teaching is not just about imparting knowledge. It is also about enabling a student to understand their own potential for learning. Do you think Gautam was an excellent teacher than a husband? So here, I'm not just comparing Gautam to be, you know, on the scale of a better teacher or husband, but I definitely think he failed somewhere as a husband, because even as a teacher, he failed because he wanted to teach, but he felt that his teachings was more important than Ahalya's teachings. And he literally felt the pain and he got irritated because of that. So I think his teachings were stopped. So he just told Ahalya that he couldn't continue along with her teachings also. So I think he failed both as a teacher and as a husband. Because when Ahalya also asked him, what about your role as a husband? He has no answer to that. So I guess he was also in a bigger dilemma.
I don't think I will say anything. I think let me just hear the views. I think we already 1.5 hours down. So I think every time we talking about, I think I'll be more keen on knowing, you know, let's discuss it that way then.
Right. So anybody wants to discuss on this?
Yeah, so that is that's an ambitious man, okay, who initially thought that he and his wife should have equal roles, but somewhere he lost the plot, which is a very human thing to do. I feel in the beginning of the relationship, the strength was their communication. And again, I feel it's very valid in today's day and time, because they stop communicating with each other. She just goes into a shell. She gets very scared. Her insecurities take over her. She is equally to blame for this. I think he failed as a husband, but I think she also failed to put across her point. And she fell into the humdrum of managing children and the ashram and everything. So the onus is on both of them. Since he was responsible for her education, he failed in that department for sure. But communication is a two-way thing. So I don't think that we can only blame Gautam for this. That's my way of looking at it.
I kind of disagree with Ruchira over here. I was more annoyed with Gautam, because marriage is a partnership between two equal people. It's a 50-50% partnership. So, and in that way, when he decides to become a celibate, he did not ask Ahalya. And when Ahalya goes and talks to him about it, he kind of makes it like, you know, she's a very carnal creature, lusting and everything. And he pushes her away, which is not done. You decided to become a celibate. You may, because you are a rishi, a maharishi at that, you would have had a flow of thought. Why not share a flow of thought with her? Tell her, this is, you know, what I thought about and this is what I'm thinking. And because Ahalya is also somebody who chose Gautam for his intellect. She is not, overly attracted to the physical things. She may have understood if he had explained his thoughts, but he never did that. Plus, as a teacher, it is your duty to teach anybody who has a thirst for knowledge. He decides to teach Jabali against all oppositions, going against the society, and he decides to teach Jabali. Then what is wrong in teaching your own wife, who you know also thirsts for knowledge? So I feel as a teacher, you have failed. You took a stand for a boy who was a prostitute's son, and you were like, no, because he has, he needs to be taught. His birth cannot decide whether he would be taught or not, and you decided to teach him. And you knew, you married your wife knowing that she hungered for knowledge, that she had the scope to improve. And thereby, by stopping, by stopping to teach her, you stunted her growth. And then you behave like a typical male chauvinist, and you decide what will happen in your marital bed also. You decide that you want to be celibate. Really? You don't think she has any desires? She has any say? So, no, I was maybe... Maybe Ahalya at fault, but there's also, you have to look at it from that point of view, that when you're pushed against the wall, you know how lonely it could make you feel. Because for Gautam, she had left everything. Because he did not like the palace, the kingdom and all. She had maintained a distance from her family. She was all alone. And then the one thing that she thinks that is hers, and that man also pushes her away. That can be very harmful, and that happens with a lot of women. You know, once they get married, they don't have a friend circle, they don't get are not in touch with their family that much. Their whole concentration becomes their husband. Their husband becomes their world, and that we are taught from a very young age. Wohi tumhara ghar hai, kind of a thing. And then, you know, if that person also is not treating you nicely, I don't think so that works. I think he failed as a husband. He failed as a teacher.
And I think Ahalya had many chances where she talked to Gautam many times and she put her point across, but Gautam was not ready to listen, or he just, you know, looked from his viewpoint, or he gave importance to himself. So I think Gautam is definitely at fault here. Ahalya did try to talk to him many times. Okay, I think the next question we can skip, because we've already done the character sketch of Sachi and we've talked about her in detail. Other than that, infidelity also point we have done. So in the book, Gautam and Ahalya have a conversation about infidelity, during which he expresses a progressive point of view. However, that quickly changes once he's subjected to it. So the same thing that, you know, he's acting like a hypocrite. Next point, the book deals in detail the awakening of Ahalya and the realization that she must first find love in herself and no one else. Don't you think this is true for each one of us? So Kavita, I think you have touched a spiritual point here also, in awakening, in the sense everybody has to realize that ultimately we all have to look for ourselves first and later for anybody, or, you know, acceptance for ourselves. So Ahalya obviously took a long time to do that, but in the end she got what she wanted, and her self-realization was very apparent when she was talking to Sita. So there, you made a good point there.
See, I feel that you can't give from a empty vessel, right? Till you don't fill up your own vessel, till you're not happy with yourself, till you're not content with yourself, how can you give to anybody else? And she gets that after some point, that she doesn't need a man. She doesn't need anybody to tell her what she is and how she needs to love herself. So that was very nice that in the end, it's not a conventional love story, that she goes back to her husband and she stays with him. And that she chooses her own path, and they very amicably move in their own spiritual pathways. So I really like that. And it was a very good way to round it up. Her self-growth was her growth. It was not because of Gautam.
The whole thing was not, the whole thing of redemption, that's why I think I've sort of not mentioned Ram too much, is, as you said, it is her redemption, it is her realization, and I think that was the awakening part of it, you know, because she had been, there's a story, of course, she was not reduced to a rock, it was a mist, she turned herself into a mist, you know, she sort of So the invisibility, I think this whole thing of how she herself, she becomes visible now. She becomes visible, she becomes visible to herself now. I think that was very important. And that is her awakening. I think that is the time she realizes that. So she becomes really visible, I think.
And I think that is true for all of us. We all have to be, you know, be awakened ourselves. I mean, nobody can help us. Even if people can teach us, we have to find a path for ourselves. And in the end, that is what is important for each soul. Okay, just the last one. It is just one single moment of weakness, that momentary lapse of judgment. That is all it takes for us to make us lose all our all in our struggle between good and bad, right and wrong, allowing the wrong to win. Isn't it true that one choice, one wrong decision affects or supersedes all our good deeds? So here, as we see Ahalya's story, only one wrong decision in one weak point made her suffer so much. So I guess this entire quote proves this point. Anybody has questions on this?
I don't understand how she's wrong. I kind of would not call it wrong, because it was her physical desire, the loneliness that pushed her this way. Maybe the people would say that she should have resisted Indra and all, but even when Indra was, she recognizes Indra and she says that, duplicate Gautam only, he wants to be with Gautam only. So then if we call her wrong, are we calling physical desires also wrong? And what if it was a man that was involved? Then again, and we have heard Gautam say that it has happened. It's not something unheard of, in where the rishis are being celibate and their wives have had physical relationships with somebody else. So it's not unheard of. And I think Ahalya was in a very lonely place. So I think in the eyes of the world, judging a woman by a very strict mandate that the world has, that, you know, there's a whole list of things and you have to tick them all and then only you are perfect. I think from that perspective, yes, one wrong step and she was condemned, condemned to hell. But otherwise, I did not find her wrong. And I would not judge her for that. It's like... it's a little too harsh to judge somebody unless you have, you know what that's they are true. Going through. And fidelity and infidelity is also very, a very debatable topic, actually. So, you know, because some people say the infidelity is also, even if you think about somebody else, so then you see an actor on screen and you think he's hot. And then for some people, that is also infidelity. They said that that's... infidelity in the mind, not pure mind and all those stuff that comes in. But frankly speaking, I would not consider Ahalya wrong. I just can't consider her wrong. For me, she is not.
So, I mean, I don't know if Ahalya is wrong or not, but she himself, you know, mentioned at the beginning when she was having a communication with Gautam that she was considering this whole thing wrong. So she was under that pressure that she's committing a crime. You know, she gave it because she wanted it so much, but she knew that it was wrong because she respected the boundaries of marriage. So for her, that one particular thing was wrong.
Yeah, but that is because that's what we are taught as, from the society we pick up. I don't know if you all ever remember, there was this movie with Tabu in it called Astitva. Mm-hmm. And that portrayed this thing very beautifully. And I remember it when I was a teenager. And because you have this thing imbibed from society so strongly, I told my mother, I said, how could she do that? Isn't taboo wrong in this? And my mom told me one thing. She asked me a question. If a man has desires, can a woman not have desires? And that has stayed with me. And that is why I feel that we are very quick to condemn women, because we have, grown up with a set idea of how women should behave. So...
We can't hear you, Neha.
Yeah, Richard, you want to
speak? Yeah. So I don't think one lapse in judgment, though I don't think it was a lapse in judgment over here.
I think the only person she disappointed was herself more than anybody else in this particular scenario, because she had her own ideals and she, in her opinion, she understood why she did it. She could, she did not try to justify it, which I think was a very big plus point in her character. She understood what she did. But as far as committing a mistake and being condemned to it, one mistake can change the course of your life. I think it can also change it for the better. Because at that time, a particular error of judgment could feel unsurmountable. But maybe that helps in your own growth. It helps you to see new strengths in yourself, which you had not thought you possessed. So I think when you're younger, you see mistakes as life-changing things. But as you grow older, you tend to look for the lesson in that. That's my way of seeing it.
Sorry, it was a lesson for her for sure. But the same way that she realized that Indra, you know, the realization came to her immediately when Indra was just asking for his own forgiveness and he did not care about her at all. So that she also understood that Indra was not at all, you know, having any feelings for her that way. So at that moment of point, she had some regret in her decision.
I don't think so. You know what? I think she knew what Indra was from the very beginning. She had a very clear idea about what his character was like. I don't think she was disappointed in him. He was basically used as a vessel to let out some frustration at that particular point in time. And as a source of comfort and as a source of basic human instinct to feel close, intimate with somebody. So I don't think she had very high expectations from him to protect her or to love her or whatever. When she was very young, when she was 16, she was very clear about his character, that he was there and he viewed women as objects, and that he did not appreciate her intelligence. She already knew that. That's why she wanted him to look like Gautam. So in a way, she used him.
Yes, that is very important why she continues with the knowing, because that is her ideal, that is a dream, that she wants that relationship with Gautam. You know, it's like he doesn't want him to change to Indra. So though she knows that he is Indra, that's very important. I think that particular factor where she doesn't, she continues with it, she makes love to him thinking he's Indra. Actually, this is the whole, that is, that shows the level, her dreams, her aspirations, her lost love, her disappointments. I think it all sort of condensed in that particular act.
Right. So I think it's time to wrap up, unless anybody has other questions. Because
we've been talking for almost 2 hours now.
Yeah, and we have dissected and, you know, discussed almost on every point and every character. So it was just wonderful discussion, Kavita. And we all, after reading the story, we all wanted to discuss it. And what better way to discuss than with the author itself? So thank you so much, Kavita, for coming and having a discussion and spending almost 2 hours with us. You know,
thank you very much, because I really enjoyed this talk, because I think you came up with such valid points, valid, you know, the whole thing was discussion, you know, because it's wonderful. It's an extremely fulfilling fact that when the author meets a reader, then you're sort of, your ideas, your interpretations, and the fact that I have managed to communicate what I wanted to say. So thank you very much, and yes, Happy New Year again.
What next?
Yeah. So Kavita, you are coming up with another novel, or as Ruchi
said,
the
book should be out in June, July. It should have been out this year, but because of the COVID, I think I sort of just delayed it.
So we can ask Meritif to book a session in August with us, you again.
Yes, I think so. Yeah, but the book is fresh. Yeah, we can do that.
So Deep, we have almost wrapped up the session. You can take it over from here.
So no, nothing else. Just thank you everybody for joining, and thank you especially to Kavita joining in. And this is our first Meritif session, live session of the year. And what better way to actually discuss the book with the author, joining the discussion. So that's great. And like Neha discussed, the first live discussion that we had done, the group discussion that we had done in this segment was of your book. And that went really well. And that is why we have continued this session. So somewhere down the line, you're associated with these sessions as well.
So, yeah, so it's all full circle every time.
Yeah, absolutely. So with that, I'll say thank you for joining, and I hope you have a great 2021. Hope you're all safe and sound, and hope to see you soon again in one of our sessions again. Thank you.
Definitely. Thank you again.
Thank you.
Thank you, Kavita. Bye.